Today's Founders Day. I thought that was a good way of starting our meeting in prelude today, and I think we've got time for just one more. And a special clap to our principal mouth organist. It was a surprise for me too. Thank you.
Welcome. Let's begin our worship and NAIDOC week with a traditional acknowledgement of country. So the Salvation Army Australia acknowledges the Gubbi Gubbi people. Here at Redcliffe we acknowledge the Gubbi Gubbi people, the traditional owners of the land on which we meet, work and worship. We pay respect to the elders and acknowledge their continuing relationship to this land, and we also acknowledge the future aspirations of all First Nations people, and commit ourselves to the ongoing living cultures of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people. Through respectful relationships and prayer, we seek reconciliation, unity. Well, welcome. It's been a week full of uncertainties, hasn't it? As we have all been watching and waiting for government announcements. I want to acknowledge those who will be joining us in worship this morning via YouTube from their lounges later today or during the week, and honour them for their choice to stay home this morning. For some, that was a very difficult decision, and we pray that God's presence would be with us and them as we all worship together. And this morning I was drawn again to Philippians 4, verse 4 to 7. Let me read with you. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all, for the Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. So let's be a people of the word this morning. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you that you are good, that you are faithful, that you are sovereign, and that you are almighty. There is no one else like you. We thank you that you are our God who knows us and loves us unconditionally. You provide all that we need and remain with us always, and we thank you. This morning, once again, we hold our people, our community, and our world to you. And as your word reminds us to lift our cares and concerns, our fears and anxieties to you, we uplift all to you. We uplift those who are afraid, those who are separated from families or loved ones, those who are grieving and have lost loved ones, those whose businesses are struggling, and workers who have lost their jobs. We uplift the many hospitals, the doctors and the nurses all around the world caring for the sick and the dying. We pray for the families and the children these school holidays, and the many more who are tired and weary from the constant changes, those who are worn out by fear and anxiety. We pray for your Holy Spirit to come with hope and peace and comfort into each situation. We pray that you would help us to care for others, to show love and mercy by doing the right thing and by sharing a word of encouragement and hope to others as you prompt us. We pray these things knowing that you answer prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. We have just a very short clip that has been put together by the Salvation Army for NAIDOC Week, and I encourage all of us to consider and reflect on what we hear and see.
Our law was given to us by our Creator. Over time, the law got broken. When people have come into Australia, they've broken down our system. They've changed the narrative about how we are and what we should be doing. They're not looking after the country, as you can see, the rivers that are being destroyed. And so our people need to go back to our way. We need to teach other people how to go back to culture, because culture will keep you strong. Your spirituality comes from the land. The land is your mother. You have to look after it. Everything that lives on that land, everything that comes from that, sustains you. So if you don't look after it, you're going to die. And that's what's happening. You know, living off the land is a big thing for our people, and it's a healthy way of living and not worrying about all the busyness that goes on in the world. I'm trying to practice my culture to my children and teach people about our culture, because it'll help you understand how we operate. When we do welcome to country, it means that we acknowledge you. We're asking you to come with us, not lead before us, but with us, walk beside us, because this is our country. It's always been our country.
Praise and worship is only the beginning of a much larger sentence, which also includes adoration, confession, thanksgiving, intercession. Our worship this morning will include all of those elements. The songs taken from the songbook are from the sections that are marked justice, and another is reconciliation. The scriptures tell us about Jesus, who was born into a poor family, living in an occupied territory, of previous generations who had been stolen and sent away, of Jesus and his family who became refugees, living in danger of their lives because of a dictator. As we worship this morning, may our minds be open to the compassionate God who acts on our behalf. And may our hearts be open to what compassion in action looks like as we live our life in our world in the coming week. Let us continue our worship as we sing with muffled voices, but with open spirits and open hearts, rejoice. The Lord is King. I invite you to stand as we sing.
Wonderful.
What a wonderful anthem, praise and adoration, hope and faith. Please be seated. We're living, as you know, in an ever-changing world. Even shopping is a challenge. During the last few days, someone asked the shop assistant down the road at Woolworths, "Where do I find the nuts?" He said, "In the toilet paper aisle." Everything is changing. You will note that some things have changed this morning that we didn't know about last Sunday. It will probably change again and again and again. You can rest assured that the Corps will be following the official medical advice. We won't be listening to the people in the aisles or some medical expert self-professed on Facebook. And so we will do all we can to keep each other safe, and we thank you for your cooperation. So welcome to worship on July the 4th. Bramwell said it was July the 5th. At some stage it was August the 20th. 75 years after all of that, Founders Day became July the 2nd. And so all over the world, people are celebrating the birth of a worldwide Christian mission, when at some stage we believe that the whole world could be one for Jesus. Hence the songs in our songbook. That kind of a vision. That's who we are. We welcome back our CEO who's opening God's word today. And we're glad, Racheal-lee, that your mum, Brenda, is still with us. We still may be saying that at Christmas time. So do we. For your sake. Lyndall Barker, I recognise you behind that mask. There you are. So welcome to Redcliffe today. We are very, very pleased to see you. And Gary has brought, David has brought Gary, young Gary, with you. And we're glad to see you, Gary. Welcome to the Salvation Army today. God bless you. Yeah, give him a clap as well. Yeah. Kerry, we haven't seen you for a long time. You're half the man that you used to be. You've lost a lot of weight. We are glad to see you, Kerry. God bless you. And John, we haven't seen you for a while. Nice to see you. Jeff, out from hospital. Hey, welcome. Nice to see you. Yeah. And Gary Leather was taken to hospital during the week. He's out now, but a little frail. So we do pray for Gary, don't we? In our prayers, we have been. Many will be joining us at home. We welcome you all into this fellowship today, this time of worship. John Drayton was to have done the announcements today, but he's still kind of finding difficult on crutches. So he's in our prayers. And we send to all our people who are at home, this congregation here, send you our love and our prayers today. May you sense the presence of Jesus. This week there will be no band of brothers. Next Sunday there will be an enrolment of new soldiers. May we know the presence of Jesus as we worship him today.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we thank Thee, you, that you make a way for all to come to you, to worship, praise, and give you thanks. As we enter into NAIDOC Week, we turn our prayer particularly to the citizens of Australia. We give thanks for the original and Indigenous peoples of this land. We thank you for their care and love for our beautiful country. We thank you for the personal gifts you bestowed upon them and the varying ways in which they worked and served this country. We pray that this legacy may continue and be shared by all Australians. We ask for understanding, cooperation, peace, and true fellowship between all Australians, whatever their heritage. Father, for those who may carry hurts from the past, we ask for your healing. We thank you for the care you have for us. Forgive us when we appear unappreciative or indifferent to your care. Most of all, we thank you that despite our faults, our sin and our frailty, in your great compassion, you made a way for us to be reconciled to you through the sacrifice and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord Jesus. And Lord Jesus, we thank you for your life amongst us, as one of us, for all the sacrifices you made on our behalf. You taught us so much, Lord. You paved the way for us, and you gave us many examples. And I would invite you all to pray with me as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is taken from John 15, commencing to read at verse 9. John chapter 15. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his father's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit. Fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command: love each other. Now we're going to sing a song, and it's written by a gentleman by the name of Khan. And it's interesting that, as we all, I think, know, that songs are written out of tragedy, out of love, out of devotion. Songs are written for all different reasons. The interesting thought about this man is that Frederick Hermann Kahn, he was brought up in Nazi occupational, when the Nazis were occupying the Netherlands. Three of his grandparents died of starvation, and Frederick Kahn became a hymn writer. He wrote hymns about social justice as portrayed in the Gospels. And so this particular song has a very deep meaning for the man who wrote these words. And so if we'd like to stand, we're going to sing this song for the healing of the nations. Lord, we pray with one accord. And we will sing the four verses straight through, and just remember, when you come to the end of each verse, you repeat the last two lines. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. The promise of reconciliation begins with the journey of First Nations people and the broader Australian community approaching the cross of Christ. Here, we sit together, sharing our stories, speaking the truth in love, that we will grow to become in every respect the mature body of Christ. It is through these stories that we acknowledge the pain and the trauma of our shared history and the ongoing impacts this has on future generations. Our hope is that the impact of truth-telling and working for justice will flow like life-giving streams throughout this land as we reach out to each other. United in purpose, we walk on as partners, committed to working towards reconciliation.
Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing to you. Amen. Who's got their Bibles with them this morning? Good. If you open them up to Luke chapter 15 and keep them open, we're going to keep coming back to it. Over the past few decades, there's been a shift in the foundations of society. Christianity and Christian principles used to be the central focus of society, but now we find ourselves often on the outside looking in, often intimidated, sometimes marginalised, and regularly misunderstood. And over time, this has actually created a bit of anger within God's people. We're angry about the values of the world. We're angry about politics. We're angry about television, about the media, about education. You name it, I'm sure we'll find someone in the church who's mad about it. True? So increasingly we have been perceived by our society to be long on judgment and short on mercy, being more committed to our personal concerns than we are to showing Christ's compassion. Although Jesus was committed to truth-telling, he did it with grace, and his life and ministry was marked not by judgment, but by compassion. We see this demonstrated in Jesus' life as he moved to the centre of crowds wherever he went. And Luke 15 contains three of the most well-known parables in Scripture: the story of the lost sheep, the story of the lost coin, good, and the story of the lost son, which we know as the prodigal son. Now, one might question what was going on, what was happening in the moment that caused Jesus to tell these three stories. But the answer is in verse 1 and 2, because they tell of the resistance between the religious people of the day and the people in their culture who didn't live up to their standards. Verse 1, it says, "Now the tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. But the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, 'This man welcomes sinners and eats with them.'" Now, Jesus was right in the center of this crowd. He was in the center of the worst kind of crowd, the worst kind of people that the Jews knew. The tax collectors were Jews who had sold out to the Romans to collect outrageous taxes from their own people, and then they added some personal tax, which they pocketed. No people in that day were more despised than tax collectors. The sinners were people who did whatever they wanted to do with no regard to the law that the Pharisees held so important, which was not just the Ten Commandments, but the 613 other laws and rules that the Pharisees expected everybody else to live by. And here, Jesus is at the center of a crowd with the worst kind of people of his day, and the religious people are on the fringes and they're grumbling about him spending time with sinners. Where would you, or where would we, consider ourselves to be today? Do we spend time with people in our society that might be considered sinners, or with people who don't agree with our theology, or who are marginalised by the world? Or do we spend our time grumbling about those who don't meet our expectations or our personal standards? But wherever you think you might be, Jesus calls us to the crowd of people he spends time and ministers with. Jesus said, "I have come to seek and to save that which was lost." And when he ascended into heaven, he said, "As the Father sent me, so I send you." Sometimes it's like we're on a mission instead of being a mission. Are we on a personal mission, or are we really on a mission for Jesus? My daughter's car broke down earlier this year, and she had to call a tow truck. And I started to think about tow trucks and how some countries they're called salvage and in other countries they're called recovery. And I thought, same vehicle, same equipment, same mission, but totally different perspective. So in different countries, some would say, "Oh, there goes a wrecker." And in other countries, they'd say, "Oh, there goes the recovery." And as I thought about that a little bit more, I thought, gee, there's a lot of people in the body of Christ that can come like a wrecker. But Jesus, he came on a recovery mission. And you know, that's why Jesus was at the center of the crowds. The Pharisees' dislike and judgment of the sinners and tax collectors was actually a theological problem. They understood God's holiness and perfection, but they knew nothing of God's compassionate, his mercy, and his justice, and his grace. And so Jesus tells these three stories to demonstrate that God, who had lost something, something significant, would not stop seeking what was lost until it was found. Yet Jesus does not overlook the sin of the crowd, because it was risky for Jesus to be at the center of the crowds full of sinners, because many would think that he wasn't concerned about sin. And I wonder if this is also a part of why he tells the story of the lost son. So in your Bibles, in Luke 15, verse 11, it says, "A certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of the estate.' And so he divided his property between his younger and elder son." Verse 13 says, "And not long after that, the younger son got together all he had and set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living." Many of us are familiar with this story. But in these two verses, Jesus makes a clear point about the weight of sin in the way the prodigal son offends his father. Firstly, asking for his inheritance early in the Palestinian culture, even today, is similar to wishing your parents were dead. It's the deepest offense a child can make to a parent, and the Pharisees, they understood that. And secondly, when the text says that he gathered all that he has, this means that he cashed up his portion of his inheritance. He sold a portion of the family land. And again, in Palestinian culture, you don't sell land that belongs to your family. Land and flocks were a family's social security system and a valuable family heritage. And again, this was understood by Jesus' hearers. Thirdly, the son squanders his inheritance in wild living. Now, aged parents made it through to the end of their life by living off the land. So not only does this rebellious son sell part of the land, he essentially spends his family's superannuation in wild living. Make sense? Now, when we remove ourselves from God's will, our sin, no matter how safe or private we may think it is, it's a deep offense to our Heavenly Father, always. And Jesus makes it clear that he understands the weight of sin as he tells of the son's descent into squalor. Notice the descent in verse 13. "He squandered his wealth in wild living." When you're wild, you do anything, whatever you want. Verse 14 says, "He spent everything." Sin is expensive. It's never an investment. When we sin, we spend relationships, we spend health, we spend time that we will never get back. And in verse 14 and 15, continues to reveal the son's descent. It says, after he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. And so he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his field to feed pigs. Think of the poverty as we read verse 16. It says, he fed himself with the pods they fed to the pigs. Now some of us have been there, maybe not trying to survive on pig's food, but we've felt the poverty of sin. We felt alone, afraid, full of shame, doing things that we never thought we would. And then in verse 17, it shows us that the son came to his senses. He says, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am, starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father. And then he practices what he's going to say when he meets his father. He says, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. So make me one of your hired men. Now this comment sent a really clear picture to the listeners of the day, because in Jesus' day there were three kind of labourers. There were bond slaves that attached themselves to the headmasters of the home out of love and out of loyalty for no return. Then there were household servants who were a little more independent and were hired men or day labourers who lived in the village, and they came to work and then they collected their pay and went home again. And in the way that Jesus tells this story, he's showing that this son hasn't come to a place of repentance. He's actually made a decision of self-preservation. He's not sorry, he's hungry. Have you ever met anybody who says, oh, I need God, but they keep God at a distance? And they may even put conditions on the relationship? In this story, Jesus makes the point that he can be compassionately committed to the worst kinds of people in society and fully understand what a weighty thing sin is in its offence to the Father and in the ruin of an individual's life. And I'm sure the Pharisees were agreeing, recognizing the subtleties in the story that Jesus is telling, thinking, yeah, these people, they're sinners. They've offended God. A bit judgmental, really. But Jesus didn't stop there. He moves from the weight of sin towards God and the worth of a sinner's life. Jesus demonstrates the value of the sinner in the Father's eyes. Have a look at verse 20. He, the son, got up, came to the father, but while he was still a long way off, the father saw him. The scriptures go on to say that when he saw his son a long way off, the father was filled with compassion for him. The one who was offended most deeply was also the one who cared most deeply. And to me, this explains why Jesus was at the center of the crowds. He knows we're all sinners. He knows that they were being judged and rejected from society, and many of them even from being able to worship. He knows they're the worst kind of sinners in the Jewish society, but he knows their worth. And he feels compassion for them, and he reaches out to bring them home. And Jesus' story continues to say that not only did the father feel compassion for the son, but he ran to meet him. And right at this point, I'm sure the Pharisees who were on the fringes and grumbling gasped. And we need to understand that context here speaks louder than the words that we read. Because a Jewish father running, embracing and kissing a sinful son would have absolutely shocked the Pharisees. Why? Because a kiss in the Palestinian culture is a sign of full acceptance and friendship. In a public way, the father received the son and in that moment restored him. The son says, "Father, I've sinned against heaven and you, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son." Full stop. He didn't say what he practiced. He doesn't ask to be made one of the hired servants, as he thought about, because of the father's actions. He recognized the compassionate actions of grace, and the arrogance that was in his spirit was melted away because the one he had offended so deeply had shown compassion and mercy and cared so deeply. And so the son threw himself on his father's mercy. This was the place of true repentance. And true repentance is when we come to God with no deals. We don't try to negotiate and we don't have strings attached. When we realize that our actions have been offensive to God and he reaches out to us, compassionately welcoming us, that's where we too throw ourselves onto the mercy of our Heavenly Father. And while some here might think that the father should put some conditions in place to avoid the son repeating his offense, this father simply welcomes him and puts a robe on him and a ring on him and sandals on his feet, signifying his reinstatement and restoration into the family. Jesus tells this beautiful story, wanting his hearers to catch the truth that God the Father recognizes the worth of all people. With a willingness to totally forgive sinners, no conditions, to be fully restored to the Father and the family. It's pretty gracious, isn't it? I believe Jesus told the story to those grumblers on the fringe to help them understand why he was at the center of the crowd of sinners. And you know, there's way more to this story, because it talks about the older son who's on the fringe and grumbles at what's taking place. But that's a whole nother sermon for a whole nother time. But I encourage you to read it through to Luke 15. Read all of the stories. Sorry, I just lost my place. When we look at those around us, both inside and outside the church, at people that we think might be the worst kind of people in society, or the people who don't measure up to our values or our standards, do we understand not only the weight of sin, but also their worth? Look around for a minute at the people that are here this morning. Just as you are worth so much to God, so are the people you're looking at. We are called to follow Jesus, to follow his example of compassionate action, and to let his compassion flow through us. To show compassionate action to all who are so unlike us in our thoughts, in our values, and even in our worldviews. do we really see others through eyes of compassion? Or are we long on judgment and short on mercy? Are we more committed to our personal concerns than we are to practicing compassion? Are we seeking others' restoration and reconciliation with the gospel of truth? And to help them see the Father and seek justice in their lives, just like Jesus did? I know that these are really, really tough questions. Who's feeling the weight of those heavy questions right now? Yeah, I am. At the end of every day, I wrestle with them too. Yet Jesus was committed to the truth, and he spoke and he showed it with grace. His life and his ministry was marked. Sorry, I'm not sure why I'm getting emotional here. His life and his ministry was not marked by judgment, but by compassion. And so this is my prayer for me and for you, that we would be marked, that we would be known, and that we would move by compassion. Albert Osborne wrote a beautiful song in our songbook, Psalm 626. It's a beautiful prayer that I'd like for us to sing and to reflect on. We know it's not easy to show compassion to people who are different than us, or where we feel helpless. But we aren't on our own, and Jesus doesn't ask us to do it on our own. We've been hearing for the last few weeks about the Holy Spirit and the power of the Holy Spirit and the enabling of the Holy Spirit. We're not asked to do it on our own, but as we're filled with the Holy Spirit, we can respond to people just as Jesus did. And I pray that we would make the chorus our prayer, that we would be moved by compassion in our words and in our deeds to all the people that God leads us to, both inside and outside the body of Christ. I'm going to invite you to stand as we sing. also speak of the application of how do we put Christ's compassion into action. And in verse 3, the second part of the verse says, O Saviour of men, touch my spirit again, and grant that thy servant may be intense every day as I labour and pray, both instant and constant for thee. I pray that if you need a greater touch on your heart, to be filled with compassion, to be intense as you labour for Jesus, then I'm praying and believing that he is filling you as you ask and as we sing. Reveals your character, your love, and your grace for us, and how we are to show the same kind of love and grace to others through your Spirit. Jesus, I pray for an outpouring of your Spirit of compassion in our lives, so that we would lead, so that you would lead us to the people that you are seeking to restore and reconcile to the Father, that we would show the same value and worth and compassion to others that you show us. We pray for the lost, those who don't yet know you. We pray for their salvation, Jesus. We pray that they would be restored into a right relationship with the Father. May we be a people who are long on compassion and short on judgment. For your sake, for your kingdom's glory, we pray. Amen. Have a seat.
Well, we thank you for God's word today and for bringing that to us, Racheal-lee. We're going to sing another song, a benediction song. It's 1006 in the songbook. We're going to sing it to the tune of St. Peter. In Christ, there is no east or west. Where we live, in our neighbourhood, in our street, where we work, where we go every day, there are those that represent east and west, those who represent north and south, those who are poor, and some of us may meet those who are rich. And as somebody said, if you've got a pair of shoes and if you've got running water, then we're the rich. We're the rich in this world. Remain seated. Let's sing this lovely song.
In Christ there's no east or west, in him not south or north, but one great fellowship of love throughout the whole wide earth. In him shall through hearts every prayer abide.
our core fellowship at Redcliffe, there are those who belong to the First Nation peoples, and we honour you this morning. There are those who have family who belong to First Nations people, and we honour you. The blessing this morning comes from a well-known Salvation Army Aboriginal leader, well-known to many of us. David, you told me something just before the meeting. Tell us about Vince Ross, the elder who wrote these words.
When Christine and I left the training college, our first appointment was to court at the Nillaquin. Who's been to the Nillaquin? What a great place. And in the Nillaquin court, there was a wonderful mission to the Aborigines, the Aboriginal people. They lived on a riverbed, the Edward River, in the Nillaquin. And we went, when we wanted to swim to cool off, we went to the Edward River, the Edward Beach they called it, and it was a lovely place. But in that humble dwellings lived this community, and the army worked there, and the army's work grew there, and people found the Lord. And one of our great soldiers at the Nillaquin was Mrs. Ross, a wonderful, wonderful trophy of grace. His whole family came to the Lord. And when they moved closer into town, into the suburban area, up from the city, they lived there and their light shone right throughout that whole area. Because they were marked out as being people of the Lord. Well, Vince was Mrs. Ross's son. And he moved to Victoria, married a lovely Salvation Army girl. And he was the bandmaster at Kyabram. And often he would come to Deniliquin and we would meet with Vince. And he was a wonderful, wonderful man of God. Well used by God, and well used by the army. And every now and then, over the years, our paths have crossed. And I noticed that on the meeting plan this morning that the benediction was written, was it not, by Uncle Vince Ross, whom I honour today.
Thank you, David. And 20 years later, I worked with Vince Ross in committees in Sydney. He was talking to us about the Salvation Army's work amongst Aboriginal communities. So here's this lovely benediction. Let's stand. Let's pray this prayer for each other as we leave this meeting this morning. May the God of creation warm your heart like the campfires of old. Bring wisdom and peace as shown to the first peoples of this land. Shake off the dust from the desert plains by the refreshing rains, followed by the glow and warmth of the sun. Let the light of God show us the right path to take and stand tall like the big river gums, drawing life from the ever-flowing waters. Amen and amen.